nose is the uppermost part of the respiratory tract and contains the peripheral organ of smell. It consists of an external nose and the nasal cavity, both of which are divided by a septum into a right and left halves. Let us first talk about the external nose. The external nose is a pyramidal projection in the middle of the face and presents with the following features. It has a root or a bridge which forms the upper narrow part and is continuous with the forehead. Then there is a tip or the apex which is present at the lower end. In between the root and the tip lies the dorsum, which is a rounded border between the tip and the root, where the sides of the nose are meeting. Then there are two piriform apertures at the broad lower end, and these are known as the nostrils or nares. The lower flattened part on the side of the nose are called as the ala of the nose. Coming to the skeletal framework of the nose. The skeletal framework of the external nose is partly bony and partly cartilaginous. So you can see this is the bony part of the nose, external nose, and this is the cartilaginous part of the external nose. Let us now study these in detail. So, the upper one third of the external nose is bony. This bony framework is formed by the two nasal bones which are forming the bridge of the nose. These two nasal bones meet in the midline and they are held together on either side by the frontal process of the maxilla. So you can see that the bony framework is formed by the two nasal bones in the midline and on either side by the frontal process of the maxilla. Now this bony part terminates in front and below at the piriform aperture. The cartilaginous framework of the nose is formed by five main cartilages. These include the two lateral processes of the septal cartilage, a median single septal cartilage, and two major alar cartilages. Apart from this, there are various minor alar cartilages which also support this cartilaginous framework. So you can see it is contributed by the lateral process of the septal cartilage, which is two in number. There is a midline septal cartilage. The superior margin can be seen here. Then there are major alar cartilages and are aided by the minor alar cartilages. Let us now study about the nasal cavity. So the nasal cavity extends from the nostrils in front to the posterior nasal aperture or the cuana behind. The nasal vestibule is the area of the nasal cavity lying just inside the nostril. The nasal cavity is divided into right and left halves by a nasal septum. So each half of the nasal cavity has the following walls: a floor, a roof, a lateral wall, and a medial or a septal wall. Let us now study about each of these walls in detail. Coming to the roof. The roof of the nasal cavity is narrow and is formed anteriorly beneath the bridge of the nose by the nasal bone and the frontal bone, in the middle by the cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone located beneath the anterior cranial fossa, and posteriorly by the downward sloping body of the sphenoid bone. Next, the floor. The floor is formed by the palatine process of the maxilla and the horizontal plate of the palatine bone. Next, we come to the medial wall of the nasal cavity. Now, this medial wall is formed by the nasal septum. This nasal septum is a median osteocartilaginous partition, means it is again made up of the bony part or the cartilaginous part present between the two nasal cavities. It is seldom exactly in the median plane, but usually bulges to one or the other side. Now let us study about the composition of the nasal septum. The bony part of the nasal septum is formed by the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid bone posterior superiorly, the vomer bone posterior inferiorly. Apart from this, the nasal spine of the frontal bone, the crest formed by the nasal bones, the sphenoidal crest, and the nasal crest of the maxillary and the palatine bone also contributes in the formation of the nasal septum. The cartilaginous part is formed by the septal cartilage, which forms the major anterior part of the septum and fits in the angle between the vomer and the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid bone. Apart from this, it is also aided by the septal process of the two major alar cartilage. Now note that the septal process of the two major alar cartilages are united together in the midline by a fibrous tissue and they form the columella. Now between the columella and the caudal border of the nasal septum, a small part of the septum is made up of the double layered of the skin with no bony or cartilaginous support, and this part is referred to as the membranous septum. Let us now study the lateral wall of the nose. This lateral wall consists of three concha, superior, middle and inferior nasal concha, and the three meatuses present below them, that is superior meatus, middle meatus and the inferior meatus. Now the composition of the lateral wall is again complicated as it consists of number of bones and cartilages. Let us see what are these bones and what are these cartilages. So the bones forming the lateral wall of the nose include from anterior to posterior the following bones: the nasal bone, frontal process of the maxilla, the superior and the middle nasal concha and the labyrinth of the ethmoid, inferior nasal concha, which is a separate bone, the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone, and the medial pterygoid plate of the sphenoid bone. So the cartilaginous part forming the lateral wall include in the upper part the lateral process of the septal cartilage. Below that there is major alar cartilage, and behind it is also aided by the few minor alar cartilages. So now coming to the features of the lateral wall of the nose. So the lateral wall of the nose is divided into three areas. The anterior part is a small depressed area known as the vestibule. It is lined by the skin containing vibrissae, which are short, stiff, curved hairs. The middle part is known as the atrium of the middle meatus. It is limited above by a faint ridge of mucous membrane known as the agar nasi. The curved mucocutaneous junction between the atrium and the vestibule is called the limen nasi. The posterior part presents three small projections, that is the conchas or the turbinates. The small spaces separating these conchas are called the meatuses. Now let us understand the details of these conchas. The conchas, which are also called as the turbinates, are the curved bony projections directed downward and medially. below and lateral to each concha is its corresponding meatus, which I have already told you. From above downwards, the conchas are superior, middle and inferior concha. So the meatuses are also superior, middle and inferior meatus. Now understand that the superior and the middle nasal concha are the projections from the medial surface of the ethmoidal labyrinth, whereas the inferior concha is a independent bone. The superior concha is therefore the smallest in size and inferior concha is the largest in size. So in this image we have removed the nasal conchas and we can see the meatuses. So this is your inferior meatus, this is your middle meatus and this is your superior meatus. So let us first see the inferior meatus. So you can see it is largest and lies underneath the inferior nasal concha and it has the opening of the nasolacrimal duct in it. Coming to the middle meatus, which lies under the middle nasal concha. So the middle meatus over here presents a bulge known as the ethmoidal bulla, which receives the opening of the middle ethmoidal cells. Below it, ethmoidal bulla, lies a deep semicircular sulcus known as the hiatus semilunaris. This hiatus semilunaris receives the opening of the maxillary sinus in its floor in the posterior part. In its anteriormost part, it receives the opening of the frontonasal duct, which drains the frontal sinus and the anterior ethmoidal sinus. So the three openings in the middle meatus are that of the middle ethmoidal ear sinus, maxillary sinus, and the frontal and the anterior ethmoidal ear sinuses through the frontonasal duct. Then above that lies, you can see over here, a small superior meatus which has the opening of the posterior ethmoidal ear cells. Now also remember that a triangular depression above and behind the superior meatus is known as the spinoethmoidal recess, and in this spinoethmoidal recess you can see there is opening of the sphenoidal sinus into it. So let us once again revise the openings in the lateral wall. In the inferior meatus, in the anterior part, there is opening of the nasolacrimal duct. In the middle meatus, in the bulla, there is opening of the middle ethmoidal ear cells. In the hiatus semilunaris, there is opening of the maxillary sinus. And there is opening in the anterior part, there is infundibulum opening of the frontonasal duct, which drains the frontal sinus and the anterior ethmoidal ear cells. Then in the superior meatus, there is opening of the posterior ethmoidal ear cells. Above that lies the spinoethmoidal recess, which receives the opening of the sphenoidal ear sinus. Let us now study about the blood supply of the lateral and the medial wall. So coming first to the blood supply of the medial wall or the nasal septum. So the nasal septum is supplied by the following arteries: the septal branch of the anterior ethmoidal artery, the septal branch of the posterior ethmoidal artery, posterior septal branch of the spinopalatine artery. Then there is a terminal part of the greater palatine artery and a septal branch from the nasal artery from superior labial artery. So the branches, I'm repeating again, coming from the anterior ethmoidal, posterior ethmoidal, spinopalatine, greater palatine and the superior labial arteries, and they are supplying the nasal septum. Now please understand, there is one area in the anterior inferior part of the nasal septum which is encircled out here. This area is known as the Little's area. Now, this area is very important clinically as it is highly vascular. Here you can see that the septal branches of the anterior ethmoidal, spinopalatine, greater palatine and the superior labial arteries are anastomosing and forming a plexus known as the Kieselbeck's plexus. This little area is the most common site of epistaxis in the children and young adults, and the most common cause of that is fingernail trauma following picking of the nose. So you should be able to remember the Littles area, Kissel's plexus, how it is formed, what is its importance, and also the arterial supply of the nasal septum. Let us now talk about the arterial supply of the lateral wall of the nose. So the lateral wall of the nose is supplied by following branches: anterosuperiorly by the anterior ethmoidal artery, anteroinferiorly by the lateral nasal branch of the facial artery and the greater palatine artery, posteriosuperiorly by the posterior ethmoidal artery and the sphenopalatine artery, and posteroinferiorly by the lateral nasal branches of the sphenopalatine artery. Coming to the venous drainage of the nasal cavity, so the veins draining the nasal cavity are form a plexus beneath the mucosa, and in generally they accompany the arteries. So the veins of the nasal cavity drain into the facial vein, into the pterygoid plexus in the infratemporal fossa, they drain into the cavernous sinus in the cranial cavity through the anterior and the posterior ethmoidal veins, and they also drain into the nasal veins in the foramen cecum. Coming to the nerve supply of the nose. So the nerve supply of the nose comes into two sets of branches. First is the olfactory nerve, which carries the sense of the smell from the olfactory region of the nasal cavity. Now these olfactory nerves, whether in medial wall or in the lateral wall, they ascend through the cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone to the olfactory bulb present in the cranial cavity. Other sets are the branches of the general sensations. So let us study these branches first in the medial wall of the nose. So as I have told you, medial wall of the nose, first it is supplied by the olfactory nerves, which pass from here, pierce the cribriform plate and opens into the olfactory bulb. Apart from this, in the anterosuperior part, it is supplied by the septal branch or the internal nasal branch of the anterior ethmoidal nerve, which is the branch of the nasociliary nerve. Then in the posteroinferior part, it is supplied by a nasopalatine nerve, which is the branch of the pterygopalatine ganglion. Coming to the nerve supply of the lateral wall of the nose, so first is the olfactory nerve passed through it, that is through the cribriform plate, and opens into the olfactory bulb. Then the nerves of the general sensation includes the following nerves. So the anterosuperior part is supplied by the anterior ethmoidal nerve. The anteroinferior part of the lateral wall is supplied by the nasal branches of the anterior superior alveolar nerve. The posteriosuperior quadrant is supplied by the posterior superior lateral nasal nerve, whereas the posteriorinferior quadrant is supplied by the posterior inferior lateral nasal nerve. Now these posterior superior lateral nasal and posterior superior and posterior inferior lateral nasal nerves are the branches of the pterygopalatine ganglion. So this was all about the nerve supply of the lateral and the medial wall of the nose. Coming to the lymphatic drainage of the nose. So the lymph from the anterior part of the nose drains into the submandibular group of lymph nodes, whereas from the posterior part of the nose drains into the retropharyngeal group of lymph nodes. A few words about the paranasal ear sinuses. Paranasal ear sinuses are air-containing cavities in the bones around the nasal cavity. They develop as mucosal diverticulum of the main nasal cavity, invading the adjacent bones. So these paranasal sinuses includes the frontal ear sinus, which is present in the frontal bone, ethmoidal layer sinus, which is present in the ethmoid bone, maxillary sinus, which are present in the maxilla, and the sphenoidal sinus present in the sphenoid bone, which is not seen in this image. Please compare it with the radiogram seen in the next image. So these are the frontal layer sinus, these are the ethmoidal layer sinus, these are the maxillary layer sinus. These paranasal ear sinuses helps in making the skull lighter, adds resonance to the voice, act as air conditioning chambers by adding humidity and temperature to the inspired air, and also help in growth of the facial skeleton after birth. The infection of these paranasal ear sinuses is called as the sinusitis. Let us now discuss these paranasal sinuses in a little more detail. Please remember all these sinuses are rudimentary or even absent at birth. They enlarge rapidly during the 6 to 7 years of age and then after around puberty. From birth to adult life, the growth of the sinuses is mainly because of the enlargement of the bones in which they are present, and in old age it is due to the resorption of the surrounding cancellous bone. Let us now discuss each of these sinuses one by one. Each is important as they are frequently infected. Coming first to the frontal ear sinus. The frontal ear sinuses lies in the frontal bone, deep to the superciliary arch. It extends upward above the medial end of the eyebrows and backward into the medial part of the roof of the orbit. It opens into the middle meatus of the nose at the anterior end of the hiatus semilunaris through the infundibulum or through the frontonasal duct. So this is your frontal sinus opening over here. Now the right and the left sinuses are usually unequal in size, and rarely one or both may be absent. Their average height, width and anteroposterior diameter is approximately 2.5 centimeter each. So these sinuses, as I have told you, they are rudimentary or even absent at birth. They are well developed between the 7 to 8 years of age and reach full size only after puberty. Their arterial supply is by the supraorbital artery. Venous drainage is into the supraorbital and the superior ophthalmic vein, and the lymphatic drainage is into the submandibular lymph nodes. The nerve supply is by the supraorbital nerves. Coming next to the maxillary sinus. The maxillary sinus lies in the body of the maxilla and is the largest of all the paranasal sinuses. It is usually pyramidal in shape with its base directed medially towards the lateral wall of the nose and the apex directed laterally in the zygomatic process of the maxilla. As I have already told you, it opens into the middle meatus of the nose. Here you can see it opens into the middle meatus of the nose in the lower part of the hiatus semilunaris. Okay, in an isolated maxilla, that is if you remove the maxilla from the skull, the opening is the large. However, in the intact skull, as you can see in this picture, the opening is reduced into a small 3 to 4 millimeter in size, as you can see over here. Because over here, in the intact skull, it is overlapped by certain bones which forms the bony part of the lateral wall of the nose. So, what were these nose? From above, by the uncinate process of the ethmoid and the descending part of the lacrimal bone. From below, by the inferior nasal concha, and from behind, by the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone. It is further reduced in size by the thick mucosa of the nose. Over here, you can see how in an intact skull, the maxillary sinus opening is reduced. The size of the sinus is variable, with average measurements of height is around 3.5 cm, width 2.5 cm, anteroposterior depth 3.5 cm. The roof of the maxillary sinus, as you can see, is formed by the floor of the orbit and it is traversed by the infraorbital nerve. You can see this is the opening of the infraorbital canal. So it is traversed by the infraorbital nerve. The floor is formed by the alveolar process of the maxilla and lies about 1 cm above the level of the floor of the nose. The floor is marked by several conical elevations produced by the roots of the upper molar and the premolar teeth. Sometimes these roots may even penetrate the bony floor to lie beneath the mucosal lining. The canine tooth may also project into the anterolateral wall of the maxillary sinus. Please remember that it is the first paranasal sinus to develop. The arterial supply of the maxillary sinus is by the facial, infraorbital and the greater palatine arteries. The venous drainage is into the facial vein and the pterygoid plexus of vein. The lymphatic drainage is into the submandibular lymph nodes. The nerve supply is by the posterior superior alveolar branches from the maxillary nerve and the anterior and the middle superior alveolar branches from the infraorbital nerve. Coming next to the sphenoidal sinus, which you can see over here. So this is your sphenoidal sinus, okay, in the sphenoid bone. So the right and the left sphenoidal sinus lie within the body of the sphenoid bone and they are separated by a septum. These sinuses are also usually the two sinuses are unequal in size and each sinus opens into the sphenoethmoidal recess of the corresponding half of the nasal cavity. So over here you can see the opening of this sinus, how it is opening into the sphenoethmoidal recess, okay, of the corresponding side of the nasal cavity. Each sinus is related superiorly to the optic chiasma and to the hypophysis cerebri and laterally to the internal carotid artery and the cavernous sinus. Please go and see the relations of the body of the sphenoid bone in the cranial fossa and you'll be able to understand this relation better. Arterial supply is by the posterior ethmoidal and the internal carotid artery. The venous drainage is into the pterygoid venous plexus and the cavernous sinus. The lymphatic drainage is into the retropharyngeal group of lymph nodes and the nerve supply is by the posterior ethmoidal nerve and the orbital branches of the pterygopalatine ganglion. Coming to the last sinus, that is the ethmoidal sinuses. Now, ethmoidal sinuses are numerous small intercommunicating spaces which lie within the labyrinth of the ethmoid bone. They are completed from above by the orbital plate of the frontal bone, from behind by the sphenoidal concha and the orbital process of the palatine bone, and anteriorly by the lacrimal bone. Just remember their location, that where they are lying. The sinuses are divided into three groups, the anterior, middle and the posterior ethmoidal groups. And you all should know where they are opening in the lateral wall of the nose. So the anterior ethmoidal sinus is made up of 1 to 11 ear cells and it opens into the anterior part of the hiatus semilunaris. Okay? Along with the frontal sinus. This is supplied by the anterior ethmoidal nerves and vessels and its lymphatic drainage is into the submandibular group of lymph nodes. The middle ethmoidal sinus consists of 1 to 7 ear cells and it opens into the middle meatus of the nose over here on the ethmoidal bulla. So this is the opening of the middle ethmoidal sinus. It is supplied by the anterior ethmoidal nerves and vessels and the orbital branches of the pterygopalatine ganglion. The lymphatic drainage is into the submandibular group of lymph nodes. Coming to the posterior ethmoidal sinuses, these consist of again 1 to 7 ear cells and opens into the superior meatus of the nose. It is supplied by the posterior ethmoidal nerves and vessels and the orbital branch of the pterygopalatine ganglion. The lymphatic drainage is into the retropharyngeal group of lymph nodes. So this is about the anatomy of the paranasal sinuses. Infection of the paranasal sinuses is a common complication of the nasal infections. Rarely, the cause of the maxillary sinusitis is extension from an apical dental abscess. The frontal, the ethmoidal, and the maxillary sinuses can also be palpated clinically for the area of tenderness in case of sinusitis. The frontal sinus can be examined by pressing the finger upward beneath the medial end of the superior orbital margin. The ethmoidal sinus can be palpated by pressing the finger medially against the medial wall of the orbit. The maxillary sinus can be examined for tenderness by pressing the finger against the anterior wall of the maxilla below the inferior orbital margin. Directing the beam of a flashlight either through the roof of the mouth or through the cheek in a dark room will often enable a physician to find out whether the maxillary sinus is full of inflammatory fluid, as in sinusitis, rather than air. This method of transillumination is very simple and effective. Radiological examination of sinuses is also very helpful in making a diagnosis. The frontal sinus, as I have told you, is innervated by the supraorbital nerve, which also supplies the skin of the forehead and scalp up to the vertex. So, the patient of the frontal sinusitis will often have pain referred over this area. Similarly, the maxillary sinus is innervated by the infraorbital nerve, and in this case, pain is often referred to the upper jaw, including the teeth. The frontal sinus, since drains into the hiatus semilunaris by the infundibulum, close to the orifice of the maxillary sinus, frontal maxillary. Hence, the frontal sinusitis usually have an associated maxillary sinusitis with it. The maxillary sinus is particularly very prone to infection because its drainage orifice through the hiatus semilunaris is badly placed near the roof of the sinus. In other words, the sinus has to fill up with the fluid before it can effectively drain with the person in the upright position. Also, the relation of the apices of the roots of the teeth in the maxilla to the floor of the maxillary sinus, we have already told you that how important it is. So please keep in mind the following applied aspects in the chapter of nose: the Little's area, which is the most common site of epistaxis children and young adults. I've already talked about this in detail, so you should be knowing about the Kissel plexus, all the arteries forming Kissel's plexus. Then next we have the deviated nasal septum. Now the deviated nasal septum is not uncommon and is an important cause of nasal obstruction. Usually males are more affected by it, and it can occur due to number of factors like trauma, developmental error, etc. If it is severe and causes mechanical obstruction leading to difficulty in breathing, sinusitis, headache, excessive snoring, it is corrected by the septoplasty or submucosal resection. Next we have the sinusitis. I've just talked about it. It is the inflammation of the paranasal air sinuses. Lastly, we have the rhinitis, which is the inflammation of the mucous membrane lining the nasal cavity. Now, the hypertrophy of the mucosa over the inferior concha is a common feature of allergic rhinitis, and clinically it presents as the nasal blockage, sneezing, water discharge from the nose, also called the rhinorrhea. A word about the maxillary sinus tumor. So the carcinoma of the maxillary sinus may arise from its mucosal lining, and the symptoms of it depends upon the direction of the growth. The invasion of the orbit may cause proptosis and diplopia, and if the infraorbital nerve is involved, there is facial pain and anesthesia of the skin over the maxilla. Invasion of the floor may produce a bulging and even ulceration of the palate. The forward growth may obliterate the canine fossa and produce swelling in the face. The backward growth may involve the palatine nerves and produce severe pain referred to the upper teeth. Growth in a medial direction produces nasal obstruction, epistaxis and epiphora. The growth in the lateral direction may produce a swelling on the face and a palpable mass in the labiogingival groove. This was all about the gross anatomy of the nose. Thank you.